is happy to be in his presence.
Hallelujah.
Amen. This morning, we'll open the service. I'll just read for us Exodus chapter 33, and I will read verse 14 and 15. The Lord replied, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." Then Moses said to him, "If your presence does not go with us, do not send us off from here. How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth?" Verse 17, and the Lord said to Moses, "I will do the very thing you have asked, because I am pleased with you, and I know you by name." Verse 18 says, "Then Moses said, now show me your glory. And the Lord said, I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." But he said, "You cannot see my face, for no one may see and live." This morning, the Lord is saying, "The glory, my glory is in the house." Moses said, "Show me your glory." But the Lord says, "My glory is my goodness. My glory is in my goodness. My glory is in my presence. I will honor you with my goodness and my presence. My glory is my mercy. My glory is my compassion." Church, shall we rise this morning? The Lord is pouring and honoring us this morning with his glory. Shall we just rise and ask God for his glory this morning? The book of Corinthians, he says that as we behold him, he's transforming us from glory to glory. Father, this morning we are in your presence, oh God. Lord, we ask that as our praises and our worship rise unto you, oh God, that you pour us, that you soak us with your glory. As the word comes forth, oh God, your glory soaks us. The glory that turns shame to greatness. The glory that turns sickness to healing. Lord, we ask that your glory will overshadow us this morning. Take all the praise. Take all the glory. Psalm 24 says, "Lift up your head, all ye gates, and let the King of glory come in." This morning, the King of glory is in the house. Amen. The King of glory is in the house. The King of glory is in the house. And let his name alone be praised. Church, let us praise God this morning. Amen. Amen.
Hey, Saturday.
Thank you, Lord, because you're always calling. You know, Father, that when we come to a place like this, Father, people come in and walk out the same way. And my prayer tonight, this morning, Lord, is that, Father, you know, heed to the call that you have upon our lives, Jesus. But when you come into your presence, Lord, it's not just to come in and out, but Lord, to stay in a relationship and to understand what your will is for our lives. And I thank you, Lord, that the most of us here, Lord, know the call. And if there's somebody here that doesn't know the call, I pray that they will hear the call this morning. I just pray that they will heed, not only repent, Lord, but Father, they will turn away, Father, from the things that separate them from you, Lord, and give them the strength, Jesus. And this morning, Lord, we surrender. This morning, Father, we come with all our worries, all our difficulties, all the things of last week, all the things that we're thinking of in the future, Lord, and we commit them to you, Lord. Lord, what perhaps our brother Chen has said, Lord, anything else is ridiculous compared to who you are, to the gospel that you give us, Lord. And we just want to meditate upon it, Lord, that the gospel, the good news that you brought us, that you gave us, Lord, is so much more profound, is so much more deeper, is so much more, Father, changing than all the things around us. And I just pray, God, that as we continue in your presence this morning, Lord, you will understand what that means by listening to your call. And we thank you for the time of worship that you brought, that you be beyond your presence right now. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your precious promises and your presence amongst us here. Take just a few minutes to thank the Lord. Just thank him for where you are. Sermon, and I was already preparing this sermon a couple of weeks ago, and when we decided to do Mark, there was a trailer video with a comment. We also have a video for every session, and I figured if it wasn't complementary to what I was going to preach on, it has certainly been inspiring. So I wanted to watch this for a second. It's 2 minutes long, and then we go into our preaching, okay?
Mark chapter 1, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." I am standing in the Jordan River right now. This is where John the Baptist was baptizing people and preparing them, giving them a baptism of repentance, saying, "Do you understand who's about to come? Look, this is not just another human being that's going to show up." He really understood his unworthiness. And as I stared at that and I thought about this and the series we're doing, do you recognize how holy this is? I've been wrestling with this, thinking, God, who am I to even speak about God becoming flesh? And I can only imagine as he's coming, like, what do you do? What would it feel like to stand in front of your Creator? These are holy, holy, holy things. Man, it is so, so sad. If you have lost the fascination of Almighty God, emptying himself and taking the form of a man. God, I pray that as we pursue and we read this book together and we journey through the life of your Son, God, that we treat this as sacred, as holy, 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 like no other news on the earth, God. Change our hearts. Help us to see that everything else is so ridiculous compared to this one great truth of you becoming man, dying on a cross for all of our sins, rising from the dead. God, teach us how to marvel again. Teach us to be fascinated with the good news of Jesus Christ.
Let me just pray before you go into the Word of God. Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for this time. We thank you, Lord, that the Father can hear your Word. I pray, Lord, use me to confine what I want to share with my brothers, Lord, that you want to share through me, Lord. I'm just a vessel. And I pray, God, that we will be hearers, and we will be listeners. Father, we will be doers of your Word. In the name of Jesus, amen. So, I'm going to just give you a little start there. We were talking about John the Baptist in the river. Now, it's funny enough, Evelyn and I were talking in the car a couple of weeks ago about John the Baptist without knowing that this video was yet to come. And just imagine John the Baptist. There's so many things we have been saying about him, about what's happening with him in the time that he was, and also how special he was, what kind of man he was. And it's not everyone that was written by the prophets, Isaiah, Malachi, and this promise that this man would come one day and that he would prepare the way for the Almighty God, Jesus incarnated, to come to the earth and to basically start something that has been changing many lives, that has changed the world of that day, and has still changed the world of this day. And if we could imagine that the Lord needed to prepare some people, or the people of that time, by sending somebody. So I suppose that message, knowing that we know, we can understand that the Lord wants to prepare, wants us to prepare a way for many more to follow. And I want to tell you this, and I said it so often here, the Lord doesn't call you to become a Christian only. The Lord doesn't call you to just come into the house on Sunday and do your religious duty, because God forbid, if that's your heart, I'm sorry, you're missing the mark. You're missing the mark so much, because that's what was killing the world of that day and it still kills the world of today, is religion. And so the Lord is, in that time, he was preparing a man called John the Baptist to prepare a way for him to come. And he was such an important character because he had things that we will learn about him today. And I think there should be things that we need to address in our lives, or that we need to take on board in our lives, in order to be as effective as this man was. And I know that we are limited. Certain things we have excuses for, certain things we are born with, certain things we acquire on the journey of this life, and sometimes we lack. And sometimes we look at ourselves and we think, I will never be like a John the Baptist. But I tell you, he was human. And the Lord will also tell you today that it's possible to be even better than him. And it's not a competition, it's not a comparison. But the Lord wants us to be of a way. The Lord wants us to do certain things. The Lord wants us to walk in certain ways. Because, as I said, you're not just here for the Sunday. And you're not here just for the Friday night. And you're not just here for the Wednesday. There's where we learn how to be a John the Baptist. We call also John the Baptist a forerunner. If you would call this sermon, somehow I would say the forerunner of Christ. And the Lord has called us to be forerunners. And somebody that forerunners, I don't know if you've ever seen, and there's certain type of races. I know, for example, and if you look at bicycle races, there's some very famous around Europe They hire people sometimes not to win the race, but to be a forerunner so that everybody can keep a certain pace. And they change positions from time to time. If somebody gets tired to be the forerunner, somebody else takes the lead and the other follows. Now, and I believe that in that way, we ought to be forerunners. We need to lead people. We need to drag people with us. We need to inspire people to run to the cross, to go and prepare a way and to clear things out of the way so that we will be able to lead people to Christ. And so John was one of that time. And as we see, even before John the Baptist, there were many other prophets. They were forerunners because all the prophets pointed to Christ. The whole Old Testament, all the people, the main characters, they pointed to Christ. But what's happened is sometime in history, the people hardened their hearts so much that we call the intertestamental era, which is from the Old Testament to the New Testament, there were about 400 years. It was like God didn't speak. It was like God was dead to the people. But their hearts were so hardened. I guess it was nothing to do with God, it was more to do with the people. Could it be possible that you go 400 years in your hardness of heart, that you ignore the voice of God, that you ignore what Christ, what God is trying to tell us? And we are at risk in the world of today that we are so complacent, we are trying to be so inclusive of the things of this world that we don't hear the voice of God anymore. And he had to send people. I'm thankful that people have put, that God has put people in my life to be the voice, to be the to make a way for us to follow and to see and basically point us to Christ. And I believe that many of you have a quiet life experience. And if you haven't, you need to look for people like that in your life. If it is from good to bad company, you need to have friends that will drag you to Christ, that will point you to Christ, that will be a light, that will also tell you, go this direction, don't go that way. And I think that's for all of us. We need to look for people, if it's because we're human, and the Lord uses people to lead us. The Lord uses people to speak to us. As I'm speaking to you today, I'm privileged and very honored that I can be here today, but I have to deliver this message. And God will put people in our lives to be forerunners, to make a way, to open up pathways so that we can see and hear clearly. And John the Baptist was one of a kind. He came as an old prophet, but he brought a new message. A message that wasn't heard before. A message that very few people could understand in that time. It was a dark world, it says. It was a violent world. It was a, there was politically, it was a divided world. Politically, it was an unfair world. Politically, and every area, morally, it was a terrible world to live in, where you could say that pedophilia was the highest form of love. I think we are not too far from it. Can you imagine that we are in a position pretty much like around us in the world? And does this world need a forerunner? Does this world need people that speak clearly, that recognize the revelation of Jesus Christ and passes it on? And John came in a time such as this. And he was in this river. And it says about John here, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light, and he came only as a witness to the light. So as I said, he came in a time that everything was falling apart, where people were religious, but they didn't have God. They were stooped in their own self-righteousness, and they were trying to make efforts after efforts, trying to make a way for themselves, and they were going nowhere. And here appears John the Baptist. And here we see in John 1:19-21, John is there. He's in this river, as we just saw in the video. And I'm paraphrasing for the time's sake, but he's there preaching. And the crowds were coming to him. And weren't just 10, it weren't a few hundred, it were thousands upon thousands coming, queuing up. And he was preaching a sermon of repentance. And because of that, many people were coming. And as we know, as you will see later on, I will mention that he was anointed with the Holy Spirit from birth. And I'm telling you, there's something about this Holy Spirit that we need to reach out to. Too many people have misused the Holy Spirit, tried to have this tickling experience, trying to feel themselves in a way and feel good about themselves, or to be a better spiritual person than another. It's never meant to be like that. The Holy Spirit was given so that people testify with power, that we would shine light on the person of Jesus Christ with a good, eloquent way, in a way that has never done before. And there comes again John the Baptist. He preaches and people could start repenting. But it was not without cost. We have the leaders, the religious leaders of that time, and they used to come, and they because they were losing faith, people, followers of them, and they were just coming after John. And what happens is they want to know, who's this guy preaching a different message than us, the religious of the time? So they sent a delegation of Levites and some is it the Pharisees? Let me see there. Yeah, as the priests and Levites are sent out there to do an investigation. And they start asking, who are you? We read about somebody to come, his name was the Messiah. And we also read about that Elijah would come again. Are you the Messiah? Or are you Elijah? And then John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet. And that is for you there, 119. As John chapter 1 verse 23, okay? I am the voice of the one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the way for the Lord. Now the Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, why then do you baptize if you are not Messiah or not Elijah or not even a prophet? I baptize with water, he replied, but among you stands one who you do not know. He is the one that comes after me. The straps of his sandals I'm not worthy to untie. So he denies being the Messiah. He denies being Elijah. He denies even being a prophet. And he says, the one that comes after me, he is the one. And we all also know there's so many other parts I'm going to skip, but I just want to put some attention. He says, the one to come, I'm unworthy to untie his sandals. And he declares himself as the lowest of the lowest. John the Baptist professes that he is that low. If you don't know what that means, there were slaves and there were servants in the time of Christ in those days. And for every task that was designated for some slave, there was a sort of a hierarchy. And the ones that used to untie the sandals of others, those were the lowest in the hierarchy of all that. Those were the lowest of the lowest. If you were a slave that had to do that, or a servant that had to do that, you would be considered the lowest. And here he says, I am so this person that I'm not even worthy to untie anyone's sandals, let's say the sandals of Christ. So he puts himself below that position. Now, and we know the message that he brought. We know the anointing that was on his life. So let me tell you this. There's something about humility in his life, isn't it? And he came, even though he was that humble. He says, repent, because the kingdom of heaven is near. That voice, repent, is not just repent. Repent is me looking that way and I'm going this way now. But that's not enough. He said, there's somebody coming that will save you, that will preach the gospel. I'm just preparing. Get rid of the filth that's in you. And he's coming to fill you with something that you have never had before. It's never spoken of in history to only a few individuals that from time to time would receive an indwelling Holy Spirit for a time. And that's it. But he says, behind, after me, the one will come. He is the Messiah. He will fill you with the Holy Spirit. And that's something that wasn't heard of. And he said, and this Holy Spirit will be the one We will cause you to be a follower, a foreigner. So he preached a message of repentance. And he also says, I make straight the way of the Lord. Now, do you know what making straight is? Straight, I could imagine a little bit like this. There was a time I worked for an interpretation company, and we used to go out to visit some illegal immigrants that they're working. And the government was after trying to see if they were not being exploited. And when the M7 was being built, you will probably heard in history of the past that there was a case with the builder of the M7 because they were being exploited. So as an interpreter, I had to follow the authorities to the motorway. And there we had to interpret the conversation, and they were being asked, what's happening, how are you working, etc. What are your conditions? But that's all I had to do. But I looked at that road, and it was semi-finished. The tarmac was beautifully made. Some of the lines were sort of put on, but there were so many machinery still on that road. There were so many sand, wheelbarrows, big trucks, big lorries, diggers, and name it, excavators, and they were all over the place. And then you go another few miles, and the same scene, the same machinery, and you wonder, how on earth is the car being able to pass this road? Before this is removed, and today we go to Dublin, and we don't even think that one day this place was congested, was littered with all those machineries and people and things that weren't supposed to be there. Now, could you imagine that, spiritually speaking, people were trying to make a way for themselves, trying to reach God. And it was all sorts of things. They were digging hard. They were trying to do things in a way that maybe it's impossible. They were littering the road that they were digging for themselves. And there were so many obstacles because they tried so hard. And there had to be someone to make that road passable before they could understand that the King of Kings one day would pass there and would bring the life, would bring the salvation, would bring the gospel that we know. Somebody had to clear it out, and I think John the Baptist was this type of guy, that he came and started pushing aside all those obstacles and started getting out of sight those things that didn't belong there. And that was the repentance that he called for. People had to leave it, stop trying too hard, because in your own strength you can't. And that was his message, repent, because there's sin in your life. There's things that you hear, things that you say, things that you watch, things that you do. They don't line up with what you're trying to achieve. You need to repent. And if you repent, truly, the Lord can come and visit you. So he was preparing this way. And as I said, we are called. We don't do just Sunday because we have to feel good about ourselves. We are called to be reminded, what is the purpose that God has got for you? What's the purpose that he has called you to be? Listen, there's people in the world dying. There's people that are trying and they can't reach God because they have those diggers in the way. Because they have those things in the way. And we could be the forerunners like John the Baptist. We could shine light. We could clear the path and make it easier for them, or perhaps for Christ to reach them. And that's why he's here. That's why I am here. That's why we are all here, to remind what Christ wants to give our lives. He has called us to be a forerunner, not just to be a Sunday Christian. To take to heart maybe your cousin, your father, your mother, maybe your best friend, maybe your spouse that doesn't know the Lord. What a privilege. It seems to be an impossible task. But thank God, the Lord has said, I'm going to give you a hint. I'm going to fill in with the Holy Spirit so that you will understand that without the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, you're still trying on your own. Since John the Baptist, I preached on it a couple of weeks ago when I preached about fasting, that his disciples were here and they were mourning in that place. They couldn't celebrate because they were mourning, because John the Baptist now, after doing what he did, had to make way for Christ to come. He meets them at the baptismal. Christ was baptized by him, and he says, "Here, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world, Holy Spirit comes on Christ." And it's awesome happening with me around. We're just talking about what could have been if you have seen that. And even in that place, what we saw in the video, must have been something quite wow. And we think that's something special about this man, that you could witness that. Yes, he did a lot of good work. But here, they were mourning. The disciples were at this feast, as I spoke a couple of weeks ago. They were mourning because this John who they followed, who they invested so much and they helped, he's in prison. Yes, he's in prison because he spoke the truth. He's in prison because he opposed those guys that were asking him, "Tell us who you are, because we need to report to our leaders what you're doing, because you do something that we never seen before. And it's, if it's religious, we need to know about it, because if it doesn't add up with what we are trying to do, you're not one of us." And it went so far that now he's in prison. And I understand that we are called to be foreigners. I am called to be a foreigner, and here he's in prison, and it says here, he was doubting now. John is to the point that he really comes and said, "Lord, I have been your foreigner." Maybe that's his thoughts, he's thinking aloud, "I have been your foreigner, I prepared a way for you, you came, you're doing what you do, and what about me now?" He sends all of his disciples, to ask Jesus. And it says, after Jesus finished instructing the 12 disciples, he went on from there and to teach and preach in towns of Galilee. And here we go. When John, who was in prison, heard about the deeds of the Messiah, he sent disciples to ask, "Are you the one who is to come, or should I expect somebody else?" And Jesus replied, "Go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor." Something is missing in this text. If you read Isaiah 61, it says, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because he has not me to proclaim this report." Isaiah 40. But there, what is missing in it is, in Isaiah, there's one verse that says, to release from darkness all the prisoners. Do you see that Jesus speaks here? He doesn't mention the prisoners, because he knows John the Baptist is in prison. But yet, whatever I'm doing, he's trying to say, is exactly, I am the Messiah. And sometimes you will be imprisoned for the sake of Christ. Sometimes you will be cornered because you're a foreigner. Sometimes you will be mocked. Sometimes you will be spit on. Because Jesus himself said, "Look, if I suffered, you're going to suffer." We know this from the Gospels. And if they've done what they've done to me, be prepared, because they're going to do it to you. And in no time, it's already started to happen to John the Baptist, because he preached a message of repentance that went against the flesh of the religious people, against their self-indulgence, if you like. And I tell you, as forerunners, we have truth. And because of the truth, we might find ourselves into trouble, in deep trouble. Because if you speak truth of the word of Christ today, it goes against what the world is at today. It's a dark time. It's a time of confusion. It's a time where people think of themselves and not of somebody else. It's everything but the gospel. And tell somebody to repent, then we are not being inclusive. The word of God is not inclusive. The truth of God is not inclusive. The truth is exclusive. It stands on its own. It has no concessions. It has no friends. The truth cuts out anything else. And Jesus said, I am the truth. And because of that, John the Baptist was proclaiming truth like it. And he finds himself in prison. Now he's asking, Lord, is it true? I have spoken the truth. And why am I in this place? Yes, you're healing. Yes, you're setting people free. Yeah, people are walking here, deaf are here. But I'm in prison and you didn't put it on the list. And Isaiah is on the list. You promised that you would set the prisoners free. We all know that he has been decapitated. He lost his head. But I tell you, it's up to the Lord to decide what is going to happen with us on this earth. I have seen young preachers die, and they were powerful preachers. Is that wrong? Listen, this is the carcass. This is just the temple of the body. And as much as I would like to live on for a long time to see my grandchildren, if the Lord takes me this afternoon or this tomorrow or in 5 minutes, it's up to him. But my life is going to be as a servant of Christ. I want to be a forerunner. If I can make a way for all of you to get there, I want to. I lay down my life. I hope you're ready to do the same for whoever the ones you love. It's not up to you to determine. There's so many of the old prophets and people that were out. Think about Joseph. He ended up in the king's prison, not in a prisoner's prison, for doing good. Isn't it the Lord who said, let the people mistreat you for the things that you do well, for the good things that you do, but not for the bad things. So here's John. In a prison on the way of being killed. Jesus speaks of him. Truly I tell you, among those who are born of a woman, there's not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet whoever is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. The call is unto you and to me. You think I will never be able to be a John the Baptist? Be humble. Humble yourself under God's mighty hand. He'll lift you up. He didn't promise that you will have an easy goal in this world. World is difficult. Life is difficult. But isn't it the greatest sense of fulfillment? And I think as Christians, we want the confirmation that God is able to use us for his will. That we can see God moving through me, through you, through yourself. If you can see that the Lord is helping you to be a forerunner. And sometimes we do look up to people and we think, oh, I give up. I'm not as good as this guy. Well, he said, if you are the least, if you dare, because that's not something that happens to you. That's something that you need to make happen. That's something that you choose to be. If you are the least, you will be greater than John the Baptist. One more thing about John the Baptist before I finish. We know that he was baptized with the Holy Spirit. We know that all what I said so far. But there was something about his clothing. He wore camel's hair as like a big fur or anything, a leather belt, and he ate locusts. How can I be a forerunner of Christ? How could I be effective? His clothes said something about him. What he was wearing was just outside. But he didn't try to live up to the standards of the world on that day. And if he was here today, I don't think he would be. And often this outward appearance has to do with what we try to look on the outside. He didn't defy himself. He didn't look for luxury. He didn't occupy his mind with a career. As a matter of fact, the Bible says he lived in the desert probably for 30 years. And when he comes out, he meets his cousin Jesus. He ate very simple food. He didn't indulge into all those luxury things. He didn't go for the top shelf. He didn't contaminate. He wasn't like an uptown guy. He wasn't like the man who was trying to make it happen for himself. He wasn't trying to look cool. Not saying that we have to go just about like him, but it's to do in the inside. See, often what you see on the outside, eventually you go review what's on the inside. And we try to cover it up many times. I could buy a nice Nike shirt, I could buy nice runners, I could buy everything, I could polish it up every Sunday morning. But the test of time will show who I am. The test of time will show who you are. And here we see, Proverbs says this here, what's on the inside, yeah? The mouth speaks of what the heart is full of. Luke 6:45 says, a good man brings good things out of good stored in his heart, and the evil man will bring evil things out of the evil things stored in his heart. For the mouth speaks of what the heart is full of. Again, this John could only speak about his master, about the plan of salvation, and we know what followed was Christ. And the words he said, there's nothing that matches it. What Christ has brought, nothing. Look at the Sermon on the Mount, and we know it's too high a standard for us to keep. What does it mean to be a forerunner of Christ? I just try to put something together. In many ways, John the Baptist shined light on Christ. When asked who he was, he points to Jesus. I am not, but he is the Messiah. In what way does our lives reflect and point out to Jesus? Are we making way for others to follow Jesus? After all, he will return and will ask you, what did you do with your life? Did you suit yourself or did you serve him? Are you the voice of Christ? Are you a forerunner of Christ? Are you making a path with your testimony of Christ? Because he did. Are there people in your life that need to be pointed to Jesus Christ? John was not popular because of what he ate, wore, or had. But from birth, he was filled with the Holy Spirit. And the message of repentance had impact because of that fact. When you were born again, the same Holy Spirit comes into your life and wants to give you the same power that the Bible calls the baptism of the Holy Spirit. John the Baptist went when he said, I baptize with water, but after me there will be another one that baptizes with the Holy Spirit. He again pointed to Jesus. So never doubt about your calling on your life. Because Jesus said, when the Holy Spirit comes over you, you will receive power to be witness until the end of the world. Baptism is a decision, a consent to immerse yourself. And like John, when he baptized people for repentance of sin, of their sin, if you're willing, Jesus will baptize you with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. To be able to be a forerunner and to shine light on him, Christ, with your life. So many will repent. Follow and see Christ for who he is. The Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Can we stand? Lord Jesus, let me just pray for a second. Jesus, Lord, I thank you, Lord, for today. I thank you, Lord, that we have examples in our lives to follow. you, Lord, that you placed all those things in the Word. And we will be inspired. Lord, we need you, Lord. First, to have to be holy, to be surrendered. But then the other way, Lord, I pray, Lord. You've given us a task that seems to be impossible sometimes. And probably more because of ourselves than anything else. So today, Lord, we come to you and we surrender again our will, our mind, our hearts. So God, that we can, Father, be effective. Lord, you are coming back. And we are looking for people, Lord, that are way makers in a sense, Lord, that are forerunners in a sense. Help us not to be obstacles, but help us, Lord, to lead people into your glory, Jesus. Lord, we have so many friends, we have so many family members. Lord, we have so many people that we wish that they would be here this morning, but they don't know you, Lord. I pray, God, use us. I pray, God, set us free, Jesus. I pray, God, help us, Lord, that we fall short, Lord. Oh God, we need you here. Help us to repent, but also to follow you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for the privilege, Lord, that we will see many people coming, Lord, true, because of the testimony we have of you, Father, in our lives, Jesus, on our lives, and the way we behave. I just pray, God, for the ones that are struggling, but yet will walk in their hearts, Jesus. Step out and be a forerunner. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus. Let's worship.
Thank you.
this morning. Hallelujah. I ask every eye closed so we can just pray. Hallelujah, Jesus. For this morning, Lord, we thank you, God, that each one of us is called, Lord, that there's a calling of each one of our lives, and the way we go, and where we work, where we do what we are, Lord, I pray, God, that we will be doers of the word, not only preachers of the word, Lord. I pray, God, that people will read our lives. Lord, I pray, God, where we fail, Lord, that we can repent, and that we can always walk with you because of that. We thank you, God, that we are not the lost kids. You walk with us every day, Lord. We thank you for the indwelling Holy Spirit. We thank you, God, that we are not alone in this journey. We are not alone doing this on our own. It's your Holy Spirit that enables us. And we thank you, God. I pray for my congregation this morning, for every person here, that they will be in touch with you through the Holy Spirit. Lord, baptize them, Lord, in the Holy Spirit, Lord. Refresh them, Lord. Retouch them again, Lord. I pray, God, strengthen them in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise God.